Buongiorno a tutti. A nome del rettore dell'Università Ca' Foscari, professor Bugliesi, che si scusa di non essere qui ma è appena da poco rientrato da un lungo viaggio in Cina, porto a tutti voi i saluti dell'Università Ca' Foscari, del rettore e i miei personali come prorettore delle attività culturali a questo Summit on Climate Change, questo Artico Ultima Frontiera, che è un'iniziativa molto importante che si situa, diciamo, a cavallo fra due o anche più di due visioni del mondo, una scientifica, e sentiremo gli interventi di questa mattina e del pomeriggio sull'approccio scientifico al problema del cambiamento climatico, ma anche artistica. Difatti questa è un'iniziativa che ha la sua origine e il suo organizzatore, una persona che non ha voluto sedersi qui perché, come tutti i bravi fotografi, il fotografo, adesso dirò il nome, è understated, è il dottor Paolo Solari Bozzi, che è seduto lì e che chiedo a tutti voi di ringraziare. Paolo Solari Bozzi in questo momento sta esibendo le sue opere, una delle quali vedete nel manifesto di questo convegno, al Museo Galleria Tre Oci, fino credo al 2 di aprile, assieme ad altri due fotografi, con tema appunto l'Artico. A partire da questa iniziativa e attraverso le relazioni, le ottime relazioni che Ca' Foscari intrattiene con i Tre Oci, oggi rappresentate dal suo direttore che siede accanto a me, Dennis Curti, a cui poi tra qualche secondo darò la parola, grazie ai rapporti consolidati da tempo tra l'Università Ca' Foscari e la Fondazione di Venezia, il cui presidente Fabio Achilli mi chiede di, appunto, di ringraziare tutti voi per la vostra presenza e di salutarvi. Noi abbiamo appunto messo, grazie a tutte queste sinergie, in piedi questa operazione scientifica e contemporaneamente artistica, culturale. È un momento importante perché è un momento di importante riflessione, lo vedete già dall'importanza dei relatori che si susseguiranno oggi nella mattina e nel pomeriggio. È importante non solo per il tema, ma per le modalità dell'approccio e appunto per le prospettive multiple con cui questo tema centrale, forse è il tema centrale, almeno di questo scorcio del XXI secolo, viene affrontato. For a while I switched to English. I've given my address in Italian, as is my duty. The conference will continue in English shortly. I switch back to Italian in a while, but for the non-native speakers of English, don't be afraid. The conference, as advertised, will be held in English. Torno all'italiano. Torno all'italiano per dire quanto l'Università Ca' Foscari sia impegnata da sempre, in particolare negli ultimi anni, nelle tematiche del cambiamento del clima e della sostenibilità. Ca' Foscari si è dotata negli anni scorsi di un ufficio dedicato esclusivamente alla sostenibilità. È un ufficio che mette insieme le competenze del personale tecnico amministrativo e le competenze del personale docente a tutti i livelli, sia personale diciamo più scientificamente, direttamente coinvolto nelle tematiche del clima, ma anche personale docente, diciamo, di tipo umanistico, per dirla con un termine ampio e vago, e si è impegnata anche direttamente nella sostenibilità. L'edificio di Ca' Foscari è stato il primo edificio universitario, credo al mondo, se non vado errato, ad ottenere un certificato LEEDS per appunto la sostenibilità, cosa non, come potete immaginare, non semplice per un edificio storico con una serie di vincoli che non rendono facili, diciamo, gli adeguamenti strutturali e tecnici per la sostenibilità. Ciononostante, Ca' Foscari è riuscita a fare di questo edificio un edificio altamente sostenibile ed è impegnata appunto nella, non solo nella tematica ma nella prassi della sostenibilità. Ecco, io mi fermo qui, non senza aver ancora una volta ringraziato tutti coloro che si sono adoperati in organizzazione di questo incontro, di questo summit, di nuovo Paolo Solari Bozzi, il professor Brabante che siede qui accanto a me e che sarà chair, oltre che speaker, chair di questa mattinata, e lascio subito la parola a Dennis Curti per appunto il Museo Treocci. Grazie.
Grazie. Grazie professore per questa opportunità. Io vi vorrei raccontare molto brevemente, perché sembra giusto lasciare spazio ai nostri relatori. La Casa dei Treocci è aperta da 5 anni e in modo continuativo proponiamo mostre e attività legate alla fotografia. Abbiamo cominciato con Elio Terwitt, abbiamo ospitato Sebastião Salgado, Helmut Newton, Gianni Berengo Gardini e molti altri autori internazionali. E devo dire che la mostra Artico, Ultima Frontiera, ha trovato una sua collocazione in modo assolutamente naturale, spontaneo e non forzato. E quindi ancora ringrazio Paolo Solari Bozzi e Marina Liverdi, che ancora nessuno ha ringraziato perché è stata l'anima vera. Si narra una leggenda che quando i nostri 3 fotografi, che potrete vedere esposti ai Treocci fino al 2 aprile, insomma in momento di sconforto durante questa lunga missione fotografica, insomma sono stati finalmente rifocillati da un piatto di spaghetti intorno al quale poi è nato tutto questo progetto, che è un'idea nata assolutamente dalla forza di volontà di Marina di riunire questi 3 autori e di metterli insieme per raccontarci poi questo progetto. Dicevo, in modo assolutamente naturale e spontaneo, perché questa non è soltanto una mostra, scusate, dico soltanto, ma non è una mostra di denuncia, è una mostra che si muove assolutamente su un doppio binario, un binario artistico, di storytelling soprattutto, e naturalmente è una mostra che è capace di mettere in evidenza, dicevamo, una battuta, un problema scottante. Questo è davvero molto, molto importante per noi. Del resto, alla Casa dei Treocci con Salgado avevamo iniziato un percorso di attenzione nei confronti della sostenibilità e dell'ambiente, e anche in quel caso Sebastião Salgado, che aveva lanciato e che continua questo lavoro su Genesi, una mostra dove per raccontare i malesseri della società contemporanea ci faceva vedere il bello, non ci faceva vedere il dramma, e questo a noi era piaciuto molto. E qui in Artico è importante, secondo me, proprio perché oggi noi riusciamo a dare un'immagine a questo luogo, a questa dimensione geografica chiamata Artico. Noi vediamo soltanto quello che conosciamo, e quindi è importante riconoscere questi luoghi, è importante che questi fotografi, diciamo, con coraggio e con determinazione abbiano voluto raccontare questi luoghi, andando anche, perdonate il gioco di parole, oltre i luoghi comuni, perché insomma lì bisogna cacciare le foche, bisogna cacciare gli orsi, e su questo si sono create un sacco di contraddizioni. Quello è quello che hanno da mangiare, e questi animali vengono cacciati. Dopodiché non è una mostra assolutamente violenta. Ieri avevamo 50 bambini ospiti alla Casa dei Treocci, che hanno fatto dei laboratori sul tema della natura. Ed è importante che questa mostra, per esempio, sia composta da fotografi che hanno lavorato completamente in bianco e nero, cercando di trovare una poetica precisa, anche questa capace di sconfiggere certi luoghi comuni che ci presentano, che ci presenta l'Artico sempre con il cielo terso e azzurro e questi ghiacci bianchi e splendenti. Ecco, non è così. I fotografi si sono confrontati con il diafano, con la piattezza di certi luoghi, e sicuramente il bianco e nero è stato davvero importante. La mostra è arricchita anche da due documentari che ben ci raccontano l'urgenza di intervenire su questi luoghi. Quindi a me non rimane altro che invitarvi per una visita ai Tre Oci, proprio perché tutte le cose, tutte le informazioni che verranno dette oggi potranno trovare riscontro andando a vedere le immagini dei nostri tre protagonisti. Io ringrazio ancora Ca' Foscari per questa opportunità, ringrazio i fotografi, ringrazio i relatori e naturalmente ringrazio la Fondazione di Venezia che ci consente di andare avanti a programmare le nostre attività alla Casa dei Tre Oci. Grazie e buon lavoro a tutti.
Grazie Flavio. I'm switching to English for the rest of the day. So it's my duty to introduce this workshop, Arctic, the Last Frontier. Polar regions in general are fascinating places. You can count about 20 million of square kilometers, about 40 kilometers of ice, a lot of fresh water, more or less 97% of fresh water in Earth is stored into the ice. And polar regions are unique Earth system because they keep a lot of information inside. They also determine the climate of our planet. They are the cooling system of our planet. They bring along a lot of water and air masses along the planet because of the current and the atmospheric transport. So they are really, really important and they're really key a component of the our climate system. But they're under threat. They are strongly impacted, especially the Arctic, because of human presence, because of what humans is doing outside the Arctic, and because of the transport of many pollutants that fly over and with the grasshopper effect are deposited into the Arctic itself. And there is also another phenomenon which is called as Arctic amplification, that amplify what is happening at lower latitude, and we'll see along the day today how this is going to affect the Arctic. As I said, polar regions are under threat. They are the sentinel of what is happening in our planets. But as we have seen, and I've seen the exhibition in Tre Oci for the first time yesterday, and I was astonished. I mean, Arctic, in this case, is really a land of hope and dreams. We have not to forget that. I mean, it's a fantastic place. It's a laboratory for us. It's clearly a laboratory. And today we want to be a scientific workshop. We have a top scientist discussing about the Arctic, the past, the present, and the future of the Arctic. And it is a pleasure to chair this session and to introduce the first speaker of the morning. The first speaker is Dr. Andrea Tilke. Andrea is the head of the Unit of Climate Action and Earth Observation at the DG Research in Brussels. I had the pleasure to work very close with Andrea in the last 4 years implementing the work program for the future of the climate research, and especially in the Arctic region. And I strongly appreciate him. He's not just a manager, a research manager, he's a scientist. So you can really discuss with him about deeply about science and what is really needed for advancing research in the future. So it's with a great pleasure that I want to introduce you and I give you the floor. Yep.
Oh, good morning. I see many known faces around. Thank you. And thank you for coming so many today. And I would like to have my slides. Okay, I start with this picture. It's a family memory. This guy on the left, Aldo Pontremoli, old man, this close to Finn Malmgren, a Swedish meteorologist. He was a physicist, and he very young, 30 years old, got the chair of the theoretical physics in Milano, at the same competition where Enrico Fermi got his chair in Rome. Fermi was 25. At that time, the professors became full professor very young, very long time ago. Anyway, he was the uncle of my mother, and he died in the Arctic, attracted to the Arctic because the Arctic was a true frontier of knowledge at that time. And he was with this Nobile expedition. You may have heard about this Zeppelin, which crashed on the ice pack. And he was one of the few who was in the upper part of the balloon, of the Zeppelin, and flew away and was never found. So he probably died in the Arctic Ocean. And but he was measuring gravitational issues, the polar magnetosphere, and so on. Anyway, the Arctic is still a frontier also for us, but it's mainly due to the dramatic changes which are happening in the globe, which are due to things that happens elsewhere, but which are so evident in the Arctic, and they are definitely due to the emissions from fossil fuel burning that is happening since the mid of the 18th century, when the Industrial Revolution started. The Arctic changes are very rapid and are impacting on this very fragile ecosystem. If you see, this is the sea ice extent. In a very few years, here we start with 1979 to 2016. The sea ice during winter time and during the summer you see this dramatic difference that happens this year, where there is a continuous acceleration of things which are changing. For this reason, last year there was the first Arctic Science Ministerial that was held in Washington, D.C., promoted by President Obama, who wished to have around the table not only the Arctic countries as they are today represented in the so-called Arctic Council, but all major emitters, all major countries in the world, because the Arctic is a global responsibility for the planet. And I'm happy to say that at that meeting where I was part of the EU delegation, we propose to have the second ministerial in Europe. It will be held in Germany in 2018, and we are going to organize it very soon. But what is happening over there? This is what is happening in the world. In the world, and you see the temperature, continuous growth of temperature. We are close to between 1 and 1.5 degrees difference between the pre-industrial era and today. But global warming is not uniform, because in the Arctic, and this is a scale in the upper north, the warming is much, much higher. Even all scenarios, this is a projection, show that by 2100, the global mean warming may be in this scenario of about 2.8 degrees. This is one scenario, it's not is the reality. I will come then later to that, but just to show the difference that if you have 2.8 degrees average warming, you have 3.5 degrees on land in average, and you have even 7 degrees in the Arctic. This is what is called Arctic amplification, and this Arctic amplification is mainly due to the positive feedback due to albedo change and to the release of greenhouse gases, but this is more a global problem, that is due to permafrost thawing. This average amplification is about 2.5 times. And the albedo change is a typical aspect because, as Carlo Barbante said, the Arctic is a cooling system, and this cooling system is mainly due to this big white area that during the summer, where it is insulated the whole day, reflects lights and, of course, reflect light, and with the light reflects also the energy contained in the light out in the out from Earth. Of course, if we start warming the planet and this amount of ice is restricted, then more black or blue-black area of the ocean is exposed, and this attracts and is warmed because attracts and doesn't reflect the light back. On top of that, of course, this not only happens for the sea ice, the ice which is floating on the sea, but it's happening on the ice sheets, on, for instance, on Greenland, and it's happening in the glaciers, in the mountains. It's happening everywhere. On top of that, the combustion of fossil fuels produce dust, black carbon, in particular the diesel, combustion of diesel engines, and this deposits on the ice, making it more black and making it capable of attracting light instead of reflecting light. So this is the some pictures of this albedo effect. As you see, if when the uniform white is starts changing, it exposes areas which are black. This and this, of course, accelerate the warming. The albedo can be calculated and is continuously reduced. This is on Greenland. And you see, but probably later, Connie will show us many other pictures like this, where you see these are this ice, but it's not white any longer. Not only black carbon, but also dust and other forms of dirt contribute to that. The permafrost thawing is another problem, because in the permafrost, is this land which is permanently frozen. If we warm this land, this contains a lot of organic carbon, and this organic carbon is starts to be metabolized by bacteria, and this release methane, release CO2, which is stored in land, and this increase the amount of greenhouse gases. This is what happens, for instance, in Siberia. Those craters are probably due to explosions of bubbles of methane that are under the earth, and at a certain point they create a crater. You see forms like that. And permafrost thawing means that also the infrastructures in the Arctic are very, very fragile. Look at coastal zones, houses are built on permafrost. They don't have any longer stability. And many villages have had to be displaced, or maybe hundreds of kilometers from the coastal areas because of risk of being destroyed. Look at this road. What is the road after the permafrost has melted? And then there is ice sheet melting, but Connie will talk about that extensively later on, so I will not stay on that. But just to say that it's not only Greenland. A few days ago, a new article on a scientific journal showed how fast is growing the melting of Canadian glaciers, which is another potential, very important contribution to sea level rise, which is so important for Venice. And then the Arctic impacts on the planet also because of other impacts. As Carlo said, the Arctic is a system that controls the climate. And during the winter in the Arctic, there is the formation of the so-called polar vortex, and which is contained by the jet streams inside the Arctic. Now, with all the changes that are happening, and it's been noticed in the last last 10, 20 years in particular, there is a weakening of the polar vortex and the cold air, and the weakening of polar vortex is accompanied by a weakening also of the jet streams. This makes cold air arriving south, because the jet streams become a sort of amoeboid shape. But if cold air goes down, there is also warm air that goes up and makes the warming of the Arctic becoming faster. There are also other tipping points that may be touched by what is happening in the Arctic. One very important issue for us and for our climate in Europe is the possibility of being warmed by the so-called Gulf Stream, the thermo-aligned circulation on the Atlantic Ocean that brings warm water from the Caribbean north, and it warms the Great Britain, warms Scandinavia, and brings, so this area, Naples is at the same latitude of New York. But New York is much colder than us. And if you imagine, for instance, the upper part of Norway, where still the climate is mild, relatively mild, corresponds to areas in Canada which are permanently frozen. Now, if this current that warms Europe changes, there is a high risk that we return to some sort of glaciation. And there are some warning signals, because what we can see is, for instance, the creation of this cold pool that is the only place on Earth that during the last years has cooled down instead of being warmed. And it may be a sign of a decrease of power of the circulation. But there are other anomalies which are happening in the Arctic, which are very strange. A few days ago, it was the beginning of February, 10th of February, it happened in the top north station in Greenland to have a jump of temperature from minus 22 to plus 2 degrees in 12 hours. Something in the winter time in Greenland. Very, very strange situations which are under scrutiny, because it happened similar things in other stations. So it was not an error of measurements due to somebody who heated a fire on that under the probe. So this is what is happening. It's we don't have to talk only of the Arctic, because also in Antarctica things are changing. And this is the global sea ice area, the global sea ice area, the last data of this year show a big decrease. In November, it was the minimum never registered in records. Because also Greenland, also the Antarctica, is recently becoming, the sea ice is decreasing again. But it's not only the impact of warming that is important for the Arctic, but also the impact of the emissions. So the presence of so much CO2 in the atmosphere, because CO2 in the atmosphere dissolves into the water, and in particular in cold waters and in fresh waters, and makes the waters become more acidic. And this means that the shells of phytoplankton or planktonic organisms that are create carbonaceous cells, they have difficulties and they may not be able any longer to create those shells. And then the Arctic ecosystems. This is not just a nice picture. This picture was taken a few days ago in Greenland and shows that Arctic cotton is blossoming about 1 month in advance to the typical blossom area time. Now, on this grass, caribous used to eat this grass, but caribous move because they do a transition and they move searching for this grass based on the photoperiodic, so the daytime. When they will start moving, they will reach this grass. This grass will have already much less nutrient content because they have already generated seeds and so on. So this may change dramatically what will be there. But then we have to talk also of the Arctic peoples because they are few. I used some of the pictures of you without asking your permission. Sorry. But I took pictures in which you find only one person. They are not many in the Arctic, but there are people. And those people are people with traditions, with knowledge, with the right of being there and to live there. Now, they are losing this right due to what has happened elsewhere, due to the emissions generated by us. Because they are now completely, without a reference, people who has used to know very well their hunting space, they don't find any longer the hunting space they had 20 years ago. They don't know where to go to search for the food based on. So, and there are many around the Arctic, and they do not have frontiers. They talk each other. Now, you hear many talking of 1.5, 2 degrees, 3 degrees, warming, and so on. What is the difference? The difference, here, this graph puts together several information. First of all, puts the information on the fact that 20,000 years ago, it was the last glaciation. After the last glaciation, we reached a temperature that was very stable. And this was capable of giving the conditions to Earth to start having civilization, because we started agriculture. Agriculture was the basis of civilization. And then in the last very little period, a big jump of temperature, depending now of different scenarios. These are scenarios, it's not... it may go up to here, to 80 degrees, but it may stay here. It depends very much on us. What we have decided in Paris, with the Paris Agreement in 2015, you may have heard about that, is to keep warming under this level, under the 2 degrees, and well below 2 degrees. Now, you know, I showed you before, we are almost at 1.5. So, very difficult, but why? Because there are a series of critical areas, critical issues, that if we go over 2 degrees, we may be at great risk. One is the West Antarctica ice sheet that may start being lost. And this is a big contribution to sea level rise. Greenland as well. Greenland if all Greenland ice sheet disappears, it's at 7.2 meters of water in average in the Earth. And Arctic summer ice, Alpine glaciers, the coral reefs, probably we have already passed the tipping point for coral reefs. So there are a number of things that we have to be very, very careful about. If we go over, and today we are on a trajectory that goes to 3 or a little bit more than 3 degrees, we can start touching the Amazon rainforest, the boreal forests, and the ocean circulation, as I said before. But where are we going with emissions? We have now a the concentration today is about 400 ppm of CO2, and we had an average for thousands of years. This is about 800,000 years ago. That was never higher than 280. And is climbing, continuously moving upwards. These are the CO2 emissions per year, how much we are emitting. And you see that fortunately, due to some changes in policies, in particular in China, there is a little bit of a slowdown of the growth. So we are not going like this, but we are now apparently coming to a sort of plateau, because China has reduced emissions, has started understanding that they are not breathing any longer in their cities. You have maybe seen some pictures of cities from Beijing and so on, which are, the atmosphere, you cannot really see around from one side to the other of a road because of the dust due to the emissions. And the United States are reducing their, but mainly because of a transfer of production elsewhere and transfer of production to China. Also, the EU has transferred a lot of production to China. India is growing very fast. This is a problem. Looking at the per capita emissions, we have still the US producing twice as much as CO2 per capita as China and Europe and so on, with an average in the world that is one-fourth of the of what one-fourth, about one, between one-third and one-fourth. And in terms of amount of emissions per dollar, China is still on top, but going down, because they are effectively switching off a lot of coal-fired power plants and transforming, moving towards more renewables and so on. Europe is well-placed, because we have a mature economy, which is mainly based on services, and because we have put forward climate policies in a quite good and effective manner, but we have to do much more. Because where should we go in order to stay within 2 degrees? You see, 2 degrees is more or less here, and at 2100, at the end of this century. We are now here in terms of emissions, so emissions per year, and we have to go down a hill which is steep and difficult, because every reduction, so if we leave things as they are, if we don't change policies, we are on the red line. So we have to go effectively to change policies in the energy system, in the transport system, in buildings, in all sectors of the economy, in order to make the transition. And the Paris Agreement, it was about that, and in particular for setting important targets to stay well below 2 degrees, and to create a system that every 5 years checks where we are and where should we go. But because in the Paris Agreement, every country has declared what they are ready to do. Now, if they execute what they have declared, we will not stay under 2 degrees, but we will stay about 3 degrees. So every 5 years now, countries have to say, okay, we will do furthermore, and each one has to contribute to that. Because if we want to get the 2 degrees, everyone has to do its part of the job. Now, let me say that the 1.5 degree that scientists are not very convinced that this can be effectively be a realistic, but it is, let me call it, a sort of ethical political target. Because if we go 2 degrees, for instance, a lot of countries in the Pacific will disappear. Small islands will be completely submerged by sea level rise. So if we want to preserve also cultures, we have to be more ambitious. We have to put more ambition. Because losing cultures is losing something which is invaluable, very difficult to evaluate. It's the basis of our life. However, something big changed, however, in the end of 2016, which is a change in the US administration. And without the US in this agreement, we will never reach 2 degrees. Because if the US do not do anything, or what we're doing, they were doing in the last years, if they stop those policies, we will go much in a much worse situation. So there are nominations of climato-skeptics in the key positions, government reports on climate change that have been removed from websites. So we have very bad signs. And in particular, a very bad sign is the general discredit of science that has come up with a consideration that science can be substituted by something else. You have heard about those issues about alternative facts that has been said. So we have to affirm today more than ever the scientific evidence. But how to do it? Because we have to understand that the success of some populistic movements, not only in the US but also in Europe, is based sometimes on the pride of ignorance, of saying, I am ignorant and I don't care. And the fact that those movements frequently see the elites as the enemies. And who more the scientists are the elites? The scientists have been always the elites. Elites also because they speak in a way that is not easy to understand. And so this is something that we have to change. We have to change because we have to take into account that sometimes scientists are arrogant when they talk about the truth, the scientific truth. And we have to change. We have to start talking more friendly to everybody and to be understandable. Oh, sorry. We have to show the Arctic, because the Arctic is a sort of canary in the mine with relation to climate change. And we have to show what is happening in the, we have to show what climate change is doing in the Arctic, because it's the most evident impact so far. And it has to be a sort of part of a broader citizen empowerment in this area. We have to increase Arctic literacy, and there are programs on that, in particularly with the Arctic Council and so on. But because also using arts and visual communication, as the case of this exhibition has been. So the way to go, in my opinion, we have to in order to avoid possible difficulties in the next years, to create new alliances, to create alliances, and for instance, with the artists, to help to give the message, because arts are the best way to transform ideas into messages that become pervasive in society. But we have to address other sectors which are maybe not never been thought about, the financial sector. Financial sector, they are responsible of money to become, and they don't want to have risks. So if you talk to a person, by the way, Paolo Solari Bozzi, before doing the photography, he was a financial manager. They talk of risks, and they don't want to have big risks. So some of the big asset managers are now going away from coal investments or things like that, because they know that they can bring humanity to a situation where there can be disasters, financial disasters. But military hierarchies, they look at security. And next week, I will have a meeting in NATO, the NATO offices, about climate security. They are very preoccupied. And the new generation, it's your future. I see so many young people here. It's your future at stake. So you have to mobilize yourself and to put ideas around. But then we have to boost scientific cooperation and to show leadership, because it's through leadership that we get things succeed. And I have to say that, not many leaders in the world has shown leadership in this area. One of them is Pope Francis, who wrote something very interesting with this encyclical on climate, on the environment, that was Laudato Si, on care of our common home. That, in my opinion, I am not a Catholic, so I don't define myself as a Catholic, but I read this text with great interest. He changes the narrative in a way that is very interesting. He says there is a beauty of this challenge. The challenge in front of us is a nice challenge, because it gives to humanity a unique opportunity to show what humanity is capable of doing, because humanity has been excellent in doing marvelous things in science and technology and revolutionary things. We have to be capable of putting things on track, and we have to be, so to prove ourselves to be capable, use our capacities for the greater good and for healing the planet. And he says, acting as a cooperator of God in the work of creation, which is important in ethical terms, because if you are not just using what somebody else has created, but you are the creator, you are responsible. So, and then he says something beautiful, saying it's no longer enough then simply to state that we should be concerned for future generations. We need to say that what is at stake is our own dignity. Leaving an inhabitable planet to future generations is first and foremost up to us. The issue is one which dramatically affects us, for it has to do with the ultimate meaning of our earthly sojourn. So it is a good point for my conclusions, because, starting from a consideration, the climate change that we have already committed with the emissions that are in the atmosphere will not allow us to save the Arctic in the sense of having the Arctic as it was visited by the uncle of my mother in 1928. This is impossible. It is another world. It is another system today. However, but we have to do whatever possible to know the Arctic, to show the Arctic, to talk of the Arctic as a paradigm of what is happening, of what is happening to our sole and unique planet that we have, and then we have to act to stop climate change. It's time to put together, I say, in a new humanism, all the creative capacities of humanity, including the spirituality shown by the Pope, provide the moral push that is needed for every one of us to become the actors of change. Thank you very much for your attention. Because in particular due to this amplification, that is due to the albedo effect. The albedo effect is the capacity of white surfaces to reflect light, but the restriction of, due to warming, these white surfaces are reduced and continuously reduced and leave open black surface. And this black surface absorbs warm instead of reflecting. And this creates for the Arctic this specific effect of Arctic amplification. So in this sense, when we talk of average global temperature, we have to consider that only one third of the Earth is covered by land or less, and the rest is ocean. Ocean is colder in average than land. So when we have an average temperature on the globe, which is 2 degrees, it's about 3 on land, and it's about 7 degrees in the Arctic. In this sense.